Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome all. It's very nice to have all of you here today, and especially folks who are not usually with us, we welcome you. I am Reverend Cynthia Crossan Harrington, and also many of you know Father Robert Kroger. And welcome. This is a very special day because we are celebrating the town's 250th anniversary, only a year late. But it's a special day in a couple of other ways. First of all, it is Father's Day, so anyone who is a father in the congregation, I salute you and start to say thank you for your service. That's not what I meant. Wrong holiday, sorry. Anyway, but welcome on Father's Day. It's also the celebration of Juneteenth, which has now become a national holiday, and you will be hearing a little bit more about that later on. So we welcome you. So let us join together in our call to worship that is printed in your bulletin. A small group of settlers became a church to worship God.
And the town of David was born.
Over the years, God has nurtured us and helped us to grow.
For 250 years, we have been guided by God's hand to become a rich and vital community.
God continues to guide us as we look to the future.
We give thanks for the abundance that is ours by the grace of God.
Let us join now in singing, O God, Bethel, by whose hand. I might mention, too, that, I should thank the committee that pretty much put together the service. So Adelia Bardwell, Kent Florio, and Jean Gripko, thank you. And apparently the last was the 50 years ago, these were the hymns, and it was suggested that we sing the same hymns. So the first hymn is number 389 in the Pilgrim or the Red Hymnal. Together in our prayer of invocation and the Lord's Prayer. Eternal and loving God, we come here giving thanks to you for your goodness through all the years this community has flourished.
We give thanks for our neighbors
and for your gift of the Spirit that has guided us over the years. May our worship reflect our gratitude as we pray now.
Jesus, Father of us, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our debts,
as we forgive our debtors.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, We are now going to sing again. O God, our help in ages past, number one, again, and then program him.
Here in our waiting heart. town of Whately.
Yes.
The following is but a small example of this. Lynn Sibley was unable to be here, and she sent the following. The Scott family was one of the original families here in, when Whately was first incorporated in 1771. The Scotts were farmers who lived on North Street for over 300 years, even when they were part of Hatfield. David Scott, known as the Master Scott, a carpenter, built the town's first meeting house in 1773. He was also one of the first selectmen. Ironically, his sixth great-grandson, my brother David Scott, was also selectman in the 1900s. The Scotts served in various roles over the years for the town and included selectman, assessor, treasurer, and town clerk. My grandfather, F. Lyndon Scott, served as a treasurer, finance committee member, and school committee member. My brother David, or Donald, also served as treasurer and finance committee member and was a Frontier Regional School District business manager for years. My dad, Lyndon Scott, was an assessor for many years and then served on the planning board. Although my name is Sibley, I carry on my family's commitment to the town and served as town clerk for 22 years and treasurer collector for 7 years. Not only did the Scott family serve the town government, but for the last 65 years, various Scott members coached many of the youth in the town. My dad, Lyndon Scott, was known by the name Coach by his former youth league members who are now in their 60s. Until he died in 2020, Lyndon's sons, David and Donald, continued to shape the youth by coaching various sports and teaching these youth the meaning of the hard work and hiring them on the farm for summers. The Scotts have also been members of the church for years. I myself was baptized and married in this church. My mom, Frances Scott, was a member of the Ladies' Benevolent Society and worked many church suppers over the years. My dad, Lyndon, worked on the Christmas Eve supper as one of the men who ran the supper. Farming has been the livelihood of the Scott families from 1600s till today. Over the years, the farm has been a dairy farm and grew other crops, such as tobacco. My niece, Jennifer Scott Swarovski, now operates a horse stable for boarding horses on the old dairy farm. Scott relatives continue to live in Whately, and I foresee the tradition of Scott serving the town of Whately for years to come. As a proud Whately citizen, I can't wait to see what the next generation will be. The following is from Paul Florio. Unlike many families that have been in town for generations, Paul is a newbie. He came to the university majoring in floriculture in the 50s and fell in love with this valley and town. He married me upon graduation and started working for LaSalle's. With a growing family, he went to work in road construction, building sections of I-91, I-495, and I-495, and Route 6 on the Cape. Being away from home much of the time, he still found time to start Boy Scout Troop Number 64 and served two generations of boys. Many grandfathers today can attest to the fun times hiking, freeze-outs, camping, and much more. Paul has also served the town as a volunteer firefighter for 30 years and has been a member of the muster team and the town's civil defense director. He served 10 years as a member of the Conservation Commission and 6 years on the Zoning Board of Appeals. He has served as town moderator for 30 years, leading many annual and special town meetings with the help of Virginia Alice if he needed it. Paul's interest in the town water resources started back in the 1960s when he worked on Interstate 91 and was involved in the excavation and in the area that is now called Tri-Town Beach. He then served on the Beach Development Committee and after the Tri-Town Beach Commission, which charged with developing the beach as the town resource. When the former Alice Water District was scheduled to be discontinued, Paul helped develop, plan, and build a new system known as the Whately Water District. This system serves families in the center of town. Many weekends after working away from home all week long, Paul could be found digging ditches in the trench for the piping. Then in 1984, when private wells servicing the town were discovered to be contaminated by agricultural chemicals, Paul and a dedicated group of volunteers persisted through thick and thin to successfully secure the state funds necessary to build a water system. Despite red tape and various other obstacles, Whately is fortunate that Paul would not take no for an answer. Finally, in 1988, $4 million water system was finished and has served the town since. He is also active in his church, serving as a Eucharistic minister, lector, and member of the choir. For many years, about September, he was let his beard grow and play Santa Claus to many kids and adults too. Many of those years were right downstairs. Several years ago, dementia set in and he could no longer serve the town, but his accomplishments will live on. John, I think it's your turn.
I should have wrote out a whole thing instead of just having notes up here. My grandparents bought a piece of property in 1933 and moved up here seasonally with my father and my grandparents for several seasons while they're building a farm. They moved up here permanently a number of years later. Now, the church was always a really important part of their life, their family life, and the community life. My father specifically started a Christian endeavor, and that's where they started making most of their friends, along with the Grange, the group that participated. My father served several times on committees, the parish committee. He worked church suppers for about 40 years, and always enjoyed that. Whately Grange was a very important part of his life. He said that that's where he learned to speak to crowds. He was always very active in that, and it's where he learned to be outgoing. He served in a lot of committees, organized different activities. They did skits, they did car rides over for different things, but he was always very active in that. I believe he served as treasurer for about 50 years. And before that, his father served as treasurer for a number of years. They had an old satchel that they had kept the records in that I think was about 80 years in service to the Whately Grange. One of the other important things that he did was in the fire department. He attained the rank of captain, and one of the most important things that he felt he did, he brought four people back to life using what's called mouth-to-mouth resuscitation before any of the other types of stuff. And before the ambulance was in town, sometimes our station wagon served as an ambulance where we'd have to move the flowers out of the back of the vehicle and load a patient in to take them to the hospital, along with several other members of town. Another important part was he, along with, I believe, Ed Farrick, formed the Whately Youth League, which eventually, along with the other towns, became the Frontier Youth League and served as a coach and mentor to a lot of kids and stuff like that. The other thing I wanted to mention is that not just he, but all the people of that generation, men and women, were so community oriented. And I spent more time with those people than I did with most of my own generation. And they were always the best people around. And sorry, I'm having a tough time up here, but my dad, as you all know, is having his issues now. But so many of that generation were so special. So I just wanted to say thank you to all of them.
I am going to read the submission from the Swift family. Harold, the third, he likes to be called Harry, brought this to my house. Harold, his father, served for many years as a volunteer with the Whately Fire Department. Prior to 911, Mr. Swift, or Harold's house, along with several other fire department members' houses, there was a red phone. This red phone was a dedicated telephone line used for either medical or fire emergencies. This phone line could also activate a siren located at the fire station, used to summon the firefighters for a call. Harold, along with other department members, responded to numerous medical calls for assistance with the fire department's ambulance. For many years, he was a member of the Whately Police Department, eventually serving as Whately's first police chief. He served on the town's finance committee, eventually serving as chairman. He was a private farmer raising cucumbers and Indian corn. His mother, Martha, taught first grade for many years at both Whately Center School and the Whately Elementary School. And I was disappointed when I found that my son, Robert, was unable to come because he's not feeling well, said he. So I don't know if that's the case or he just wanted to get out of this so mother would read it. I'm reading this as he would be speaking. I am Robert Bardwell, and I'm told that I was named for the Robert Bardwell who settled in Hatfield about 1675. I was privileged to view his home site that was excavated by Randy Dong in 1915. Lieutenant Noah Bardwell moved to Whately in 1769, and I think there has been a Bardwell here ever since. My grandfather's cousin, Victor Bardwell, lived on Poplar Hill and was often referred to as the mayor of West Whately. He is known to be responsible for the building of the West Whately Chapel. My great-grandfather, Irving Ellis, established the water supply for the center of town. My grandfathers, Fred Lee and Edward Ellis, served as cemetery commissioners, as did my Uncle Kenneth Daniels and my parents, Fred and Adelia. Uncle Ken was a town moderator in the 70s. My dad served on the planning board, Board of Selectmen, and was chairman of the 200th celebration. My mother was on the school committee for 9 years. My Aunt Virginia was town clerk for 38 years. My brother Keith was appointed highway superintendent in 1986. We were told that he was the youngest one holding that position in the state at that time. Fred and Adelia served as trustees for the will of Oliver Smith, and now Keith has been elected to that position. I have always been proud to say I was born in Whately. We're going to hear from the Smiths. Thank you, Richard.
Thanks, Adelia. This is probably the first time that I've ever spoken from a pulpit. I'm really hoping the good Lord is in a good mood today. And if you see a blinding flash, you'll know I was wrong. My Uncle Ed Schmorowski was tax collector in the 50s, 60s, and into the early 70s. And I'm sure many of you can remember going into his pine-studded den with your checks in hand and handing over your dough, either to him or to his wife, Alberta, who assisted him from time to time. His brother, Francis, my father, was coincidentally an assessor at the same time. They never heard of the word collusion, so I assumed that there was none going on between the guy setting the rate and the guy collecting it. But anyway, both he and his wife, Mildred, also participated in the bicentennial parade planning back in 1971, and I was quite amazed when Mom managed to walk the entire parade with everyone else. My brother Bill, as you all know, has been a policeman, a fireman in town. He was a water superintendent from pretty much when the water system was installed until fairly recently, and he still consults with Wayne Hutkoski from time to time. You have been sending him to the Frontier Regional School Committee since 1976 as your representative, which I suggest might constitute a record of sorts. He and his son Zachary have been involved in this planning and execution of this particular celebration as well. And for a time, when he was in slightly better condition hip-wise, he did run up and down the court with our children refereeing basketball games. As I mentioned, Zachary's probably going to be making your chicken Friday night, and he also is a fireman in town. Bill's late wife, Kathy, served as a library trustee right after the turn of the century. Brother Bob, 40 years a teacher at Frontier Regional, one of the winningest athletic coaches in the history of Massachusetts sports, chaired the elementary school building committee in 1990, and then served as the select board's representative on the Frontier Building Committee. So if there's anything you need built, I guess Bob's the guy to talk to about organizing that. He's been on the Zoning Board of Appeals for the last 30 years and is currently the president of the Library Trustees. His wife, Mary Ellen, is the president of the Friends of the Library as well. Which brings us to my favorite topic, moi. Anyway, no, just kidding. I've had a great privilege over the last 3 decades of serving with some of the most capable and intelligent people, creative, dedicated individuals that you can imagine. I've done this on the Board of Selectmen as your moderator, presiding over town meetings and so forth. Earlier on, as a member of the Planning Board. The theme that runs through everything that I've seen and everything I've heard here today is the fact that we as a community operate in a collaborative, supportive, mutually understanding way. We have our differences, of course, and my God, I've had people standing in my foyer screaming at me about dog situations and every other manner of problems. But on the other hand, every time I drink a glass of water from my tap, or I go to our beautiful schools, attend an athletic event, or a gathering like this, I realize what a wonderful community I live in. There's an old African proverb that I've been thinking about, and it's simple. If you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. I think we have gone very far indeed. Thank you.
Brad and Alan Sanderson couldn't be here today, so I will be reading their biography. I also, Richard, this is my first time at the pulpit, but my pastor, Father Kerber, will tell me how well I did. These are the words of the Sanderson family. Our grandfather, William Sanderson, was born in 1891 in a small home on Grass Hill in West Whately. He and his family attended the West Whately Chapel. The stained glass front door was a gift from Bill and his family. Bill worked for Seth Kratz on Mr. Kratz's farm on North Street. After Mr. Kratz's death, Bill was tasked to sell the many parcels of land that the Kratz family owned throughout Whately. In the early 1930s, Bill and his wife Madeline purchased the dairy farm on North Street from Mrs. Kratz and named it Fairview Farms. William and Madeline had 3 children. Neil, Marjorie, and Alan. All these kids were very involved in Whately Grange, the church, and the Whately community.
Like his father, Neil was a selectman in Whately. Alan was involved in the Lions Club, the building of the youth center, which is now the police station, and was an officer in the Whately Fire Department. Alan and his wife Beverly continue to give their time to the town. Both of them contributed significantly to the Whately 200th birthday celebration. Beverly was the postmaster of Whately for many years. Together, Alan and Beverly had two children, Alan Jr. and Bradley. Both sons were part of the Grange community, are members of the church, and have served on many committees and boards in town. Alan Jr. is a selectman and serves on the Community Preservation Committee, and Bradley was on the committee that brought cable to our town. Both were members of the fire department, as well as EMTs. Alan's wife, Cindy, was a member of the Whately Elementary School Committee and of the Historical Commission. In 1984, the Sanderson family purchased the former Consolidated Cigar Company farm on Long Plain Road. Fairview Farms currently raises flowers, greenhouse tomatoes, and tobacco. Alan Jr. and Cindy have two children, Megan and Jake. Megan and her husband Dan have two daughters, Virginia and Bridget. Jake is probably the ninth generation Sanderson to farm the soils of Whately. Brad's daughter Tara and her partner Ben have two sons, Bryson and Corey. Brad's wife Kamani has written a wonderful book on the Sanderson family titled The North Street Corridor. Alan Jr., Bradley, their children, and grandchildren all live in Whately. I would just say that I'm very pleased to say these are just a few of the Whately families who have served us very well through the years. I would like to now introduce Karen Skrosky. I'm sorry, Ellen Skrosky, who will tell you the biography of the Skrosky family.
I'm very nervous as well. But I do want to say one thing first. When Kit Florio was reading the Scott family history, I don't know how many of you know this, but my son Joe is married to Jen Skrosky. And it was a real to-do at the time, saying, an East Whately's marrying a West Whately? But I can't be any prouder that my granddaughter, Isabel, has such a rich history between the Scott and the Skrosky family. And they are my family. Okay. Frank and Helen Lipinski both immigrated to the U.S. from Poland when they were teenagers. After they met and married, they lived in New York for a few years. At the time, Frank worked as a conductor for the Grand Central Railroad. They had numerous friends and relatives throughout the Pioneer Valley, which is why they relocated to this area. In 1910, they purchased their home and farm on Christian Lane from John Pease. Not only did Frank farm the land, but he worked for the Postal Service as well. He was in charge of hanging the bag of mail for the railroad to pick up, and then of course leave another bag for them to drop off, pick up, and then another bag for them to pick up. Oftentimes those bags were ripped, broken, mail spread. His wife Helen was known for baking extra loaves of bread to feed the homeless that traveled on the railroad. She was also noteworthy. It's also noteworthy to mention that she operated a still in the basement. She did not give that to the homeless men. Shortly after they moved and established their farm in Whately, Frank became good friends with Lyman Crafts, who was actually his mentor in farming the land. Throughout the years, the second generation of Skroskys were born. Frank and Helen had seven children, five of which continued to reside in Whately. The oldest was 19, and the youngest, my father-in-law Frank, was six years old when the original homestead burnt to the ground after their neighbor's house caught on fire. Fortunately, the barn was saved, so the family could live there while they rebuilt the existing house. Their youngest child, Frank Jr., enlisted in the U.S. Air Force and served as a tail gunner in a B-24 during World War II. The average survival rate for that position was 15 missions. He flew 49. Additionally, he and his squadron were one of many who bombed the famously known Plesti oil fields in Romania. After returning to Whately, Frank Jr. married Helen Zubkevitz. They purchased the homestead on Christian Lane from Frank's parents, and Frank's parents moved to a smaller house on the farm. He farmed the land, worked at UMass as a custodian, and drove a school bus for the Whately students who attended Smith Vocational School in Northampton. He also served on the Whately School Committee. His two sisters, Grace and Wanda, built houses on each side of the farmhouse. His older brother, Bill, built a house and farmed the land across the street. Bill also worked for the Highway Department, and his son, William Jr., served on the Tri-County Beach Committee for numerous years. Wanda's husband, George Duval, was a volunteer fireman and town constable. Wanda and Georgiana had two children, Georgiana and Donald, both of whom still reside in Whately. Georgiana has worked in the town as an EMT, volunteered on the Whately Historical Society, and is currently on the water commissioner. Don served for 50 years on the fire department. Frank Jr. and Helen had twin boys, Donald and Frank, in 1951. Both graduated from the University of Maine, and while Frank eventually worked for the federal government as a U.S. Marshal, his position required him to relocate to many different cities throughout his lifetime. Don married me, Ellen, in 1973, and we lived in Maine, where he became a teacher. We relocated to Whately in 1977 with our two daughters, Diane and Heather, after Don accepted a position at the Whately Elementary School as a principal. A few years later, our son Joseph was born. Don, his brother Frank, our son Joe, and his cousin Don Duval at one time or another participated on the Whately muster team. Joe's doing that this afternoon too. In addition to being a school principal, Don was also a physical education teacher for grades K through 6. Because neither school had a gymnasium, in the winter months, the physical education class took place at the Whately Youth Center, which is now known as the police station. This additional job title, as he was once a bus driver, transporting the class to and from their classes. Throughout the years, Don coached Little League baseball while his cousin Georgiana also helped with coaching and serving as an umpire. He served on the planning board for several years. He was nominated an award for the Whately Grange Citizen of the Year, and the annual town report was dedicated to him. He was a member of the school committee for the present Whately Elementary School. The school library was dedicated to him and is referred to as the Donald A. Skosky Library. For the last 5 years of his career, Don was the principal of the Frontier Regional High School. After he retired, he served as school committee member for the Whately School for 9 years. Our two daughters, two of our children, Heather and Joe, reside here in Whately. Our daughters, Diane and Heather, when they each had children attending Whately Elementary School, coached numerous Whately soccer, basketball, and baseball teams. Our oldest daughter, Diane, who lives in Hatfield, is also a teacher at the Whately Elementary School. She teaches second grade. Though they haven't committed to any service in the town of Whately, all five of our grandchildren have or still attend Whately Elementary School. And I will say, I was not born in this area, I was not raised in this area, but Whately is my hometown and very proud of it.
To renew the faith and special.
Before I recognize Juneteenth, I need to say thank you to the committee, the choir, the people who spoke. It was wonderful. Thank you all. When we talk about Juneteenth, I had to look up the definition, and so I read it. It is a festival held annually on the 19th of June by African Americans, especially in the southern states, to commemorate emancipation from slavery in Texas on that day in 1865. And now, as you know, it is a national holiday, and so we recognize it today. And it's been universally spoken with every time you listen to the television. It's really, really great that it's recognized around the world. But this is our little bit of Whately. The man I'm speaking about is George Prutt. And I have to tell that Derricka Smith, our archivist at the Historical Society, was able to research this for me to read. The only known enslaved person in Whately, George Prutt, was the son of Arthur and Joan Prutt, a family owned by Reverend Isaac Chauncey of Hadley. George was born about 1719 in Hadley, one of seven Prutt children. As they grew up, the Prutt children were divided among the Chauncey children. Richard Chauncey and his wife Elizabeth brought George with them when they came to live in Whately with their daughter Abigail and her husband Jonathan Smith. Richard and Elizabeth Chauncey were founding members of the Whately Church when it was organized in 1771. And George, called by Kraft, our historian, called him a pious old slave. He joined the church with them. Slavery in Massachusetts ended in 1783, but even as a freed man, George, who was now in his 60s, remained in Whately. He died of putrid fever on the 18th of September in 1794, outliving Richard Chauncey by 4 years. His death record is in Whately, and it is presumed that he lived those 4 years with Jonathan, by then a widower. There is no known gravestone. So that's Whately's little bit of history with early time.
Thank you all. It's wonderful to, as you know, I'm a transplant, but my heart is now in Whately. So it's wonderful to hear all about the history, and you did a great job of putting it all together. Thank you so much. And thank you to the choir, and I echo all that Adelia said about in terms of the thank yous. So, all right, let us join our hearts in prayer. Creator God, here we are today in the celebration of this town and this community joining with other faiths to acknowledge how we've all been part of Whately or impacted by Whately. For 250 years, this town has grown. Its people have prospered. We give thanks for the guidance and the gifts and the talents of all those who have worked so diligently to make this town one to be proud of. We give thanks for all those who have carried on over the years to bring us where we are today. We ask your blessing on all people who call Whately their home, past and present. May their children and their children's children continue to work together in love and peace. May we go forward today with this positive energy, as Terry mentioned, with a new vision that will sustain us in these difficult times and in the years to come. May this same loving spirit propel us into the future. As we celebrate the history of our town and all that it means to each of us, we also recognize that this is the commemoration of Juneteenth, celebration of the end of slavery. This day reminds us of the progress we made, but it also reminds us of the progress that we have not made, in recognizing that we are all children of God. Loving God, grant us the grace to contend fearlessly against evil and to make no peace with oppression. Help us to move forward to respect each person as each and every person is precious in your sight. We ask your blessing too on our fathers, that they may know how important they are in the lives of their families. Give them the courage and the strength to be equal to this task. We're also thankful for all the blessings that we have in our lives, the blessing of this beautiful day, the blessing that we are able to come together to recognize this 250th anniversary. The blessing that we have many wonderful events to go to this afternoon and like the Fireman's Muster and in the weeks ahead. And we give thanks too for individual things like Stephen being approved for a mortgage for his house. And now in this time of silence, we make our individual requests and thanks known to God. Send us out today, O God, with pride in our past, empowered by your Spirit. And what we speak, what we have spoken and sung in worship today may be reflected in our future. How we live toward others and toward you, O God. In the name of the divine, we pray, no matter what you all perceive the divine to be. Amen. Today. So if anyone would like to contribute anything, there are offering plates in the back that you can do so. I will invite up for our final hymn one of the illustrious members of our committee, Jane Grootke, who sometimes fills in for us, often with us calling her in a panic and saying, help! And she comes forward. So Jane will be playing the last hymn, God of our Fathers, whose almighty hand, number 433 in the Red Hymnal.
Thank you.
benediction, again, I'd like to thank everyone, including Father Korber, whose name I apologize for mutilating when I first introduced him.
Oh, you're not the first, you won't be the last.
I used to know somebody named Kroeber, so I think that's what I said.
They're close.
Anyway, so thank you for taking part, and thank you all for the choir and the committee, and did a wonderful job. Much appreciated. It is also our custom after the benediction to remain seated or to sit for our beautiful postlude that we have. So now let us go out today, cherishing our rich history, guided by God's hand. Let us go forward, informed by the past, but with a hope for a future of peace and harmony, where each person is respected and valued. May it be a future where love and justice bond us together. Go now in peace and love.